Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Bad Parents by S.L. Harker, narrated by Whitney Dykhouse. Prologue. Detective Sandra Buchanan, a tall woman with a sharp-edged bob, steps out of her unmarked police car and takes in the street around her. Madison Lane. Not the kind of place she usually finds a body. Not among the flawless lawns and draping wisteria blooms. Not where the houses are set far back from the road with long drives curving to the street. The air is heavy with a velvety floral scent. Everything about this place screams privilege. Two or three steps toward the crime scene and that sweet floral perfume turns rotten. She's smelled it before. Blood. Even in the hazy early morning, it's easy to spot the body. The deceased is bulky, probably a man, folded over on himself at the end of a driveway. She approaches slowly, noting the smear of blood running across the sidewalk. A tire mark brands the arm, which lies at a wrong angle, twisted and bloody. Sandra stands, placing her hands on her hips, and looks at the road, then at the driveway. Why is there no blood in the middle of the street? Did the car come onto the sidewalk to run this man over? Either the driver was completely out of control, possibly drunk or on drugs, or it was a deliberate hit and run, a murder. The patrol unit's arrival spurs her detective nature into action. She addresses the officers, directing them to set up a perimeter and search the area for anything that appears unusual. The officers fan out and tape off the scene. She watches them drop numbered cards near blood trails and the lone shoe in the house's driveway. Sandra studies the shoe for a moment, turning it over carefully in gloved hands. Then she regards the house. One of her officers consoles a weeping woman standing in the doorway. The wife or a neighbor? Definitely the wife, judging by the tears. If that's true, then this man barely made it out of his driveway before becoming roadkill. How about that for luck? Sandra turns slowly, taking in the street. She feels eyes on her, sees a curtain close hastily over a window, notes the shadows of neighbors lurking behind blinds. And she wonders if here, on this quiet street, in this quiet neighborhood, in this quiet town, perhaps one of the neighbors had a not-so-neighborly reason to hate the man. If someone behind those curtains and blinds hated him enough to want him dead. Chapter 1. The door to the bar whooshes shut behind me and I blink, adjusting my eyes to the dim interior. It's just after 6, but already patrons perch on wobbly bar stools nursing their beers. Let's face it, this is a dive. The floors somehow manage to be both sticky and gritty. Stale cigarette smoke lingers in the air. I gingerly pick my way across the room, scanning the boots with cracked plastic upholstery. Petra! I turn to see Dawn Lines half standing and waving to me from a table near the back wall. We're over here! Lifting my hand in greeting, I skirt a few empty tables and settle onto a rickety chair at the table. Good evening, ladies. I smile at Dawn and Amy. So, this place is interesting. I wipe the sticky table with the edge of my hand. Do they serve tetanus shots with your drinks? Amy Winstead, a petite brunette, titters nervously, her eyes flicking between me and Dawn. I don't know her well, but she's always been quiet and slightly nervous when I've talked to her at the neighborhood barbecues and block parties. It doesn't help that her 4 kids are shrieking little whirlwinds, and her husband Miles is useless with them. He's one of those man's man types. Too traditional to change a diaper. Brash and raucous, always giving the women smirking winks like he's seen them naked. Amy probably finds it hard to be heard in her own house. Between us, Dawn and I have made it our personal challenge to bring her out of her shell. I know, Dawn says, but it's the closest place. Plus, I can drink as much as I want without any judgment. She shrugs. Anyhow, welcome to the first Madison Lane Mom's Evening Out. Anybody up for shots? I only have a couple of hours before I need to be back at the office for a meeting. Don't you work at the middle school? Amy asks softly. Absolutely, which is why I need alcohol. Dawn laughs. She shoves her chair back and struts toward the bar. I glance at Amy. She's kidding. Her eyes widen. Oh! Amy, school shut hours ago, you know that. I laugh. Well, that's why I was confused, she says. I pat her on the arm, hoping she'll loosen up soon. Dawn's just a tease. For a while, Amy sits very still. Only her fingers move as she picks at the edge of the table. She pulls them back and folds them into her lap when she notices me watching. How are you? I ask. Is everything okay? Fine, I guess. Her smile is tight, her lips closed over her teeth. It's the same smile I give people I don't want to talk to in the grocery store. How are you? She finally asks. I'm fine, thank you. This conversation is going nowhere fast, so I'm relieved when Dawn returns from the bar, balancing a tray on one hand. You look like a professional, I laugh. Dawn gives a quick spin, showing off her waitressing skills before depositing the tray on the table. I waited tables all through college. She quickly passes out the drinks, glasses of water and shot glasses full of a golden liquid. Tequila! Dawn announces triumphantly. And vodka sodas, she adds, just as Amy takes a sip and starts sputtering. Amy giggles nervously. Shoot, I thought it was water. Nope, not tonight, Dawn says. This is a special occasion, ladies. It's not often we get time with just us. No kids, no husbands. I lift my glass to Dawn. Abso-fucking-lutely. We deserve this. Between carpooling each other's kids, looking after our husbands, doing our own jobs, and living our own lives. How many fires have you put out this week, Amy? Well, Aaron did stick a dime up his nose last Tuesday. And I bet you drove him to the emergency room, I prompt. Miles was in the middle of... I cut her off. Miles knew you'd deal with it. But now it's time for you to unwind a little and let him put out some fires. She smiles. You're right. Dawn grins at me when Amy raises her glass. To the Madison Lane moms, Amy says. We quickly pick up our glasses and clink them together. I'm surprised to see Amy take a long slurp of her vodka soda. Getting her out of the house seems to be working. Dawn and I down our tequila shots, but Amy seems more hesitant this time. Dawn obliges by taking Amy's, too. And for the first time, I'm concerned. Dawn likes to party, but I've never seen her drink quite like this. Her glass thumps onto the table. Everything okay? I ask. You're going hard there, lady. I keep my tone light so as not to bring down the mood. She waves a hand. Yeah, great. Things are a bit hectic at work. I got passed over for that promotion I told you about. For the English department? What, really? They went with an outside hire. She raises her eyebrows. And guess who's had to train him? She scoffs. Jesus, I'm so sorry, Donnie. I grab her hand. Yeah, that's terrible, Amy adds. Sorry to hear that. As Amy sips her drink, her phone pings and she grabs it immediately. I think I need to go. What? We've only had one drink! Dawn sticks out her lower lip in protest. Miles is having trouble with the boys. I should go. He struggles on his own, she says. With his own kids? I blurt. It sounded a lot more judgmental than I had intended. Amy smiles thinly. Sorry, there's dinner to make. And Bads, I really do have to go. Thank you for inviting me, though. It's been so nice to see both of you. Amy stands, her hands brushing her skirt. I'll see you for carpool. She hurries out, her eyes on her feet and her cheeks burning pink as she passes the bar. What was that about? Dawn mumbles. She's a little shy, that's all. I mean, you've seen her at neighborhood functions. It's just the way she is. I shrug and sip my drink. No, she says. It's more than that. Something's going on. We're both quiet for a moment, thinking about Amy. We know she has an overbearing husband. We just don't know if we have more to worry about. Dawn breaks the silence. It's a shame she didn't stay for another. I bet she has a wild streak just waiting for the right time to come out. Dawn, she's got 4 kids. I think we know when her wild streak comes out. True, true. Dawn cackles. Anyhow, how have you been? She settles back into her chair and swirls the ice in her drink. I've been okay, I guess. The lie weighs on my tongue. Can I tell Dawn I'm not really happy? That every day I think that moving to the suburbs was the worst thing I've done? Do I tell her it's been almost a year since I've had sex with my husband? That my kids drive me insane? That I've lost so much of myself that I don't even recognize myself in the mirror anymore? I'm not sure I can. But I can tell Dawn wants more. The kids can be a bit much, at times. Yeah, I know what you mean. Especially when they're young. Even at 6, Jamie takes up so much of my time. You'd think after the breastfeeding was done, they wouldn't be as hands-on, I guess you'd say. Very clingy, you know? Always touching me, Dawn says. Oh my God, yes, the touching. I get so touched out by the end of the day. I didn't realize before I had kids how much of my body I'd literally have to give them. I shake my head with a sigh. I don't know about you, but it makes it hard to get excited about climbing into bed with my husband at the end of the day. The last thing I want is someone else touching me. I grab my drink and gulp it, worried I've said too much. I feel Dawn's eyes on me. I know what you need. Dawn says. Music. Come on, that jukebox has to have one good song. She points to the machine, shoved into the corner, dust muting the neon lights. She grabs my hand and pulls me up, laughing as she tugs me across the room. Oh, these songs are ancient. I laugh as I scan the list. Oh, no. Dawn says with glee. These are fabulous. Madonna, you know we have to. Before I can stop her, Dawn shoves coins into the machine and pushes furiously at buttons. The machine hums and clicks, and the first thumping strains of Material Girl pour from the speakers. Dawn takes my hand and spins me around. Between the drinks and the swirling, I grow lightheaded. And we dance right in front of the jukebox. The men stare at us over their pints at the bar. It feels good. Dawn spins me again and the lights around me blur. Another song comes on, Spice Girls this time, and we bounce around, our hands in the air as we scream the lyrics. Dawn heads to the bar and orders a few more shots, which we drink while dancing to 90s pop tunes. We must look like dorks, dancing alone in a dive bar. But the alcohol buzz worms its way through my veins. Then the energetic beat slows down. I catch my breath and adjust my skirt, sensing those lonely men staring at us. The rhythm turns languorous. Whatever this ballad is, it has a sensual beat. I don't know this one. I turn to go back to the table. Oh no, we're dancing our way through all these songs. Dawn pulls me back to her and drapes her arms around my waist. She sways and takes me with her. I'm feeling the drinks, so I just giggle and loop my arms around her neck, swaying against her. Suddenly, I'm aware of Dawn in a way I wasn't before. Her soft vanilla scent and the way her natural curls shiver around her heart-shaped face. Up close, her skin is almost perfect. Just the slightest of puckers at the corners of her eyes from smiling. A freckle marks her upper lip, right in the center. I lean forward and press my lips to hers. Dawn stops moving and stiffens. But before I can pull away, her hands find my face, and her tongue pushes into my mouth. She tastes like tequila and lime. Her lips are almost desperate against mine, like she's searching for something in this kiss. I let her kiss me until my head buzzes, and a chorus of cheers and catcalls interrupt us from the bar. Dawn pulls back from me and studies my face. All she says is, "Well." Chapter 2. Dawn drops her arms and steps back with a laugh, but it sounds high and fake.
"Tequila will do that, I guess."
"Oh, absolutely," I choke. "I don't know about you, but I've had way more to drink than usual."
"Especially since it's so early," Dawn agrees. "And hey, that was no big deal, you know."
Her fingertips flutter over her lips before she drops her hand.
"We let the drinks go to our heads."
"Absolutely," I say again.
"I think we ought to get an Uber home."
Dawn pulls out her phone and taps at the screen.
"You want to share?"
"What?" Her words snap me out of my thoughts.
"An Uber," she repeats. "I know I'm in no shape to drive, and I don't think you should either."
Yeah. I'm still stunned by what happened, but Dawn seems to take it all in stride. I don't know, maybe it's normal for her. Maybe she goes around kissing other people all the time. Even with the alcohol to blame it on, it still has me shook. Mainly because it just so happened to be the best kiss I've had in a long time. But I don't tell her that. Instead, I grab my purse and follow Dawn out onto the sidewalk to wait for our Uber. Neither of us say anything on the ride home. All the lights are off in my house except a lone lamp emitting a yellow glow across the foyer. It's barely 9, but Andrew is an early riser, so he's probably already in bed. I shut the door and turn the lock, wincing at the shotgun-like crack it makes. Slipping off my shoes, I tiptoe across the hardwood floor in my bare feet and ease up the stairs, skipping the one in the middle that creaks. In the moonlight peeking through the curtains, I can just make out the lump under the comforter that is Andrew. He shifts, and his light snoring stops when I push open the bathroom door. I freeze until the soft sounds of his snoring start again. I wait until I'm in the bathroom with the door closed before I flip on the lights. Shucking off my shirt and blouse, I wrinkle my nose at the smell of liquor and stale cigarette smoke lingering on them. I shove them deep into the laundry hamper and make a mental note to drop off dry cleaning tomorrow. I debate a shower but decide it will probably wake Andrew. Instead, I splash water on my face. That's when I notice the smudges of light coral lipstick around the edges of my lips. Not a color I would ever wear. I grab a washcloth, run it under the water, and scrub my face. Did Dawn and I really kiss tonight? My slightly swollen lips and the feeling of guilt roiling through my stomach says yes. But like Dawn said, we let the drinks take over. It isn't a big deal, is it? And really, I tell myself as I change into one of Andrew's old college t-shirts and climb into bed. It's no different than when I was at college. Girls used to kiss each other all the time, mostly to try and excite the guys. This was essentially the same thing. We knew we had an audience, and we played up to it. Chalk it up to too much alcohol. That's all it takes, really. Andrew sighs and rolls over, his hand finding my waist. He squeezes sleepily and the guilt rushes back. I turn my back to him, tuck my hands under my cheek, and try to sleep. For some reason, I can't stop thinking about Dawn's lips on mine. Then another intrusive thought pops into my head. If the kiss didn't mean anything, why do I feel guilty? Andrew and I have always had a modern relationship. We've allowed ourselves space. He wouldn't care about me and Dawn playing up to a crowd by being a bit sexy, a bit racy. He wouldn't care about a kiss between me and a girlfriend as long as it didn't mean anything. So I'm fine. Aren't I? Oh my God. I groan and pull a pillow over my eyes to shield them from the sun streaming through the crack in the curtains. My head throbs and I groan again.
You must have had some night.
The bed sinks as Andrew sits on the end.
I didn't even hear you come in.
You sleep hard. I sounded like a cow stomping around in the bathroom. Ow. I roll over and take the pillow with me. Andrew laughs quietly and runs his hand over my blanket-covered backside.
How about I take the kids to the park for a bit? Give you some time to get over the headache?
Would you? Relief floods me when I realize I won't have to get up and make pancakes while the kids fight over the iPad. Then I remember what happened with Dawn last night, and the guilt rears its head again. You don't have to. I swing my legs around and sit up, pushing the pillow away. My stomach lurches and my vision blurs. I place both hands on my head and groan.
I think maybe I should,
Andrew says, his voice low.
You really want the kids to see you like this?
Okay, point taken, I say, noting his tone. Just don't take them to the place on Third. That playground always has cat poo in the sandpit. The park over on Maple is better, and it has bathrooms. I drop backward and pull the pillow over my head again. Love you, babe.
See you later. Love you.
The bathroom door snicks shut and I'm alone. I close my eyes and drift to sleep again. After a couple of hours of sleep, I force myself out of bed and into the bathroom. The nausea is gone, but the headache still throbs. I didn't even get home late, but those shots really did a number on me. Studying my swollen, bloodshot eyes in the mirror makes me wince. I turn away and start the shower. 20 minutes later, I feel better, if still a little shaky. Downstairs, I toss back a couple of Tylenol with a tall glass of water and look for the pack of saltine crackers that I know are in the back of the pantry somewhere. I settle in at the kitchen island with another glass of water and the crackers, and watch the backyard through the window as I munch. The roof of Dawn's house is just visible across the back, 3 houses down. I grab my phone and pull up her number, gnawing on my bottom lip. Hey, should we talk about last night, now that we're sober? I put the phone down and finish my crackers and water. When my phone finally pings a text notification, I snatch it up. It's not Dawn, though. It's Amy, apologizing for leaving so early last night. I answer her with a, "Don't worry about it, hun, it's fine." Dawn still hasn't texted back, which makes me nervous. Does she hate me now? How will she act the next time we see each other? I don't get the chance to worry about it anymore because Andrew and the kids come back from the park, announcing their hunger as soon as they pile through the door. Laughing, I pull the kids in for a hug before suggesting I make fried chicken tenders for lunch.
Yours? Not the ones from the box?
Olivia's pretty brown eyes narrow with suspicion. Yep, mine. You can help if you'd like. I move to the cabinets and pull out bowls and ingredients.
For lunch? Isn't that a lot?
Andrew gives me an odd look, and I wonder if he can tell that guilt drives my reason for suggesting a home-cooked meal instead of sandwiches or something warmed up from the deli.
Sure, why not? I've got the time. I lean up and kiss his cheek.
And you've had them all morning. Why don't you go catch a game or something? We'll call you when lunch is ready.
I won't say no, Andrew warns me with a grin. You're the best.
He turns and heads back to the living room. Okay, monkeys, who wants to pour the flour? I pick up Luca and settle him on my hip while Olivia pulls a chair up to the counter.
I do,
she chants. So for the next hour, I patiently guide the kids in the art of frying chicken. And I don't think about Dawn once. One of those statements is true. Chapter 3. Come on, let's hurry. I jump out of the car and run around to open the back door and help Olivia unbuckle her booster seat. I still have to walk your brother to pre-K.
'Cause he's a baby,
Olivia says firmly.
I'm not a baby,
Luca retorts. The telltale signs of a tantrum flash across his face. The downturned mouth, the way his fists clench and his eyes narrow. No one thinks you're a baby, I fumble with the latches on his seat.
Only the babies have their mommies walk them to class. Not like me,
Olivia says proudly as she hitches her backpack over her shoulder. Luca's face falls. Olivia, leave your brother alone, and wait for me before crossing the street, I call as Olivia skips ahead to the sidewalk. After getting the kids unloaded, I grasp them each firmly by the hand and pull them to the crosswalk, where we wait patiently for the crossing guard to guide us. After sending Olivia down the hallway to her class, I lead Luca to his room, leaning briefly against the doorframe to watch him put his jacket and lunchbox in his assigned cubby. He turns and glares at me with a 4-year-old's rage, so I blow him a kiss and head back out. As I go over the day's errands in my head, stopping at the market, picking up a prescription, finding a gift for a birthday party the kids are attending over the weekend, I spot Dawn at the school gates. She never answered my text after our mom's night out, and I haven't run into her since. Dawn, I call, raising my arm. When she notices and gives me a wave, I trot across the schoolyard to join her. Hi, I say breathlessly. How are you?
Fine.
Her eyes remain on the kids, streaming in through the gate. Good morning, Stacy.
Colby, no running, you know better.
Lovely hat, Sophia. She's in teacher mode, greeting both kids and parents. A moment later, her dark eyes flick toward me.
How are you?
Oh, fine, you know. I fidget, suddenly feeling a little ridiculous. You never texted me back.
I didn't realize I needed to.
Dawn continues to wave at the kids, greeting several more by name.
I'm busy right now, Petra. I'm sorry, I won't keep you long. I just wanted to know, did you tell Lewis about Saturday night?
My voice drops low, though it's hard enough to hear over the din of the kids arriving. Dawn's eyes regard me again.
Why would I tell Lewis? Did you tell Andrew?
The line of kids dwindles and a bell chimes in the building behind us.
I didn't, I admit. But I've been thinking about it, thinking maybe I should. I don't know.
I stop and wait for Dawn to say something.
I didn't tell Lewis because it wasn't a big deal. So we kissed.
Dawn casts a glance over her shoulder before lowering her voice.
We were drunk, and it just happened. I'm not in the habit of telling my husband everything that happens to me. Are you?
No, I guess not. Her answer, along with her tone, rankles. Maybe she makes a habit of kissing people she's not married to, but I don't. Well, usually. I just felt, I don't know, guilty is all. At this, Dawn turns to face me. Petra, don't be ridiculous. Sheen laughs. You have nothing to feel guilty about. It's not like we fucked. Didn't you ever kiss a girl in college? It's like that. Well, yeah, but that's not the same. I wasn't married then. I shift my feet, regretting that I came to talk to her. She doesn't seem to share the same concerns. I can't help but wonder if Dawn makes a habit of drunken kisses. Don't be such a prude, she says. We got drunk. It's no big deal. I chew on the inside of my cheek, searching for a way to tell Dawn I'm not a prude. I just don't feel right about not telling Andrew what happened. It's not like this happens every day. Before I can think of anything to say, though, Amy spots us from across the schoolyard and heads over, her youngest, Hunter, strapped to her chest. Isn't he a bit old for that? Dawn blurts before saying hello. From the way she looks at her feet, she regrets saying anything. Perhaps she's still riled up from our conversation. Hi, Amy says. Maybe. He's 3, but he's still small. It helps to have him strapped down while I'm corralling the other 3. Her smile indicates she didn't take offense, but I still feel bad that Dawn snapped at her. Morning, Amy. I smile and notice the dark circles under her eyes. I'm not judging. I would be tired too if I had 4 kids. Sometimes it seems like I can barely function with 2. It's been nice seeing you ladies, but I really need to get into the office. We have a few parent conferences to get through today. Dawn turns to go inside, but Amy stops her. Oh, just a minute. I wanted to check and see if we were still doing game night. At your house, right? Amy turns to Dawn. I don't know if you mentioned it on Mom's night. No, I don't think I did. Dawn responds, her eyes sliding to me. Sorry I left so early. I just really needed to get home to the kids. But I look forward to game night. She shifts Hunter to get his knee out of her ribs. Oof, Hunter, maybe you are getting too big for this. Anyway, should I bring something? I wouldn't say no to a bottle of wine, Dawn says. But it's not necessary. Okay, that sounds good. Petra, walk you to your car? Amy gives Hunter a little bounce. Sounds good. I glance at Dawn. See you both at game night, then. Dawn turns quickly and heads away from us. I hesitate, watching her leave. What was that? Dawn seemed almost furious with me, but why? Come on, I say, pulling myself out of my thoughts. I'll help you get Hunter into your car. I run my hand quickly over Hunter's down-covered head. We head down the sidewalk, and when I glance over my shoulder, I'm almost sure I spot Dawn standing at her office window, watching us go. Chapter 4.
Do we have to do this?
Andrew stands with 1 foot on the bottom step of Dawn and Lewis's front porch.
Honestly, I have work to get done at home, and wouldn't you rather watch some housewives show?
Grabbing his hand, I pull him up the steps. Don't drop that wine, I warn, pointing to the bottle nestled in the crook of his elbow. Sure, I could throw on sweats and watch TV, but we never go out anymore. Remember going out? We used to do shows, clubs, and concerts all the time before we moved here. Don't you miss it?
This isn't exactly a club, Petra, Andrew says. Game night with the neighbors. I have to admit, not exactly what I thought we'd be doing when we moved.
He reaches the second step.
But I hear what you're saying. I know I've been working late quite a bit recently. I'll try to make it home earlier sometimes. Maybe we can go for drinks or dinner soon. Just the 2 of us.
Deal. I grin. But we're here now, and I don't want to let Dawn down, so let's try to enjoy ourselves, okay? He nods, and we cross the porch. As Andrew knocks briskly on the door, my heart thumps. What's wrong with me? It's just a game night. I flex my hands, trying not to think about my last meeting with Dawn. She'd been so strange that day, so cold. Finally, the door opens and Lewis, Dawn's husband, stands there smiling.
Andrew, he booms. How's it hanging?
He claps Andrew on the shoulder and tugs him through the doorway. He turns to me and his eyes drift from my feet to my head, stopping to take a healthy gaze at my breasts.
Petra, lovely to see you,
he says, his eyes still on my chest. He steps back and waves me in.
Go on back. Dawn's in the kitchen.
I feel his eyes on my ass as we walk through the house. I glance down at my cleavage. I guess I did put on a slightly tighter dress than usual. But why did I do that for game night? Like Andrew said, it's hardly the opera. Shaking away the feeling from Lewis's not-so-subtle gaze, I follow Andrew into the kitchen to find Amy and Miles already here. They sit at the kitchen island with a tray of sliced meats and cheeses in front of them. Amy has a glass of wine in her hand, but she just seems to swirl it around. Miles, his tie already askew and his slightly thinning hair rumpled, quickly works his way through a bottle of beer. Hi, Amy. How are the kids? I walk over and give Amy a quick hug.
Oh, they're great. She puts down her glass and pushes it away. They've got their favorite sitter tonight, so hopefully they'll be worn out and in bed when we get home.
She laughs quickly like she's said something scandalous.
I mean, I'd love to see them before they go to sleep, but...
Nobody cares about the kids, Amy,
Miles interrupts.
I swear they're all you ever talk about. Let's try and stick to grown-up topics tonight, okay?
Miles is a big man with a broad back and thick neck. Even his fingers are thick. Amy is a sparrow to his hawk, tiny and delicate. I have a quick flash of the two of them in bed together, somehow figuring out how her petite figure fits with his hulking frame. I shake the thought out of my mind and turn to Dawn, who opens a bottle of wine and pours it into two glasses.
Here.
She slides the glass across the counter toward me before picking up the other for herself.
You need to catch up.
So that's the way it is. Things are still tense between us. Tomorrow I'll call Dawn and set up a time so we can talk about what happened without anyone interfering. But in the meantime, I down my wine in a few quick gulps and push it back toward Dawn. All she does is raise an eyebrow before pouring me another glass. After a few minutes of small talk, Lewis claps his hands together and rubs them, looking around at the group.
Okay, who's ready to get their ass whooped?
Andrew and Miles immediately boo him, and they all stand and head toward the family room, punching and ribbing each other. Dawn, without a word, gestures toward me and Amy, and we get up and follow the men. We've hosted a few game nights, and somehow it always ends up like this. I like to think of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.